you. It is very rare that we have an opportunity like this at Design Indaba to come together and for 3 days reflect on creativity in such a supportive community. And that's, I think, something to be thankful for. And I'd like to start with some music. What better example of creativity is if you take something that has been used and overused, like Vivaldi's Four Seasons, and give it a new life? Music that has almost become meaningless by overuse in commercials, and then you recompose it, resample it, and restitch it together. And this excerpt will be just a little over 2 minutes. I'd like us all to take a little moment, maybe form an intention for the 3 days ahead. Close your eyes, sit comfortably, breathe calmly. And this is from Max Richter's Vivaldi's Four Seasons Recomposed. Music is a remarkable thing. Intuitively, we understand the power that music has over us. We use music to get in the zone, to concentrate, to be more productive, sometimes to prime ourselves for performance, be it on stage or an important presentation or something that requires a special attention. In fact, it's known that before the debates, the live television debates, he would listen to Eminem's Lose Yourself. And so opportunity comes once in a lifetime, and then your headphones drop out, and then you go on. Now, in addition to this intuitive understanding that we all have of the power of music, there's stronger and stronger directional evidence in scientific studies. And those studies are of two kinds. There's basic neuroscience, so understanding what is happening in the brain when we listen to music or we play music, as well as more clinical studies looking at the health effects and particular outcomes. And if we take the first, in terms of the foundational neuroscience, it turns out that when we listen to music, the brain and its circuits fire very broadly. So at least hypothetically, it is possible that we could complement or replace some pharmaceuticals using the appropriate sound and music. The clinical evidence is interesting across a range of conditions, but I'll just highlight one which is more surprising, and that is pain. It turns out that music can be used to manage pain and reduce our need for opioids. In one study, and these have been replicated in different settings, in the case of day surgery, so this is post-operative pain after an operation, acute pain, half the group gets 1 hour of music after the operation, and the other group gets no music, standard of care. The group that gets the music self-administers a third of the morphine of the other group. Now, given the kind of opioid epidemic that is, at least in the United States, is on right now, and a lot of it starts with acute incidents of pain or injury, it would almost seem that if it's not a right, then at least it should be an opportunity for everyone to listen to the right music after an operation. So this mounting scientific evidence is in the background. And then you may ask, what makes it possible for us now to consider this topic, to make music as precision medicine a reality? Well, for one, we have a celestial jukebox in every pocket in the form of a streaming service like Spotify or Apple Music or SoundCloud. We have an explosive growth in biometric sensors, be they on our wrist, in our phones themselves, on our finger, like this ring, which measures sleep. And we have finally access to machine learning and cloud computing at scale and as a utility. We can buy it. We don't need to build, every startup doesn't need to build it. And so against this background, what we've done is build a platform to collect data, mapping music characteristics to their biometric effects. And what I mean by music characteristics are things that you would all intuitively understand, and those of you that play music would as well. It is things like tempo, beat salience, as neuroscientists would call it, how clear a groove of a music, how easy it is to tap your foot to something. The color or the timbre of the music, the instruments used, is it strings, is it more acoustic, is it more electric? And key, as well as direction, how the amplitude and the volume of music, how it's growing. And then we take any possible evidence on the biometric effects of that music. And the key thing is that we're collecting the data across scales. So starting from one end of the scale, the incoming funnel is over 10 million playlists on public music services, like a Spotify. And we analyze those playlists that have words like de-stress in their title, or exercise, or concentration, or reading, or coding. And we take that as evidence that someone has used this music for this purpose and it has worked for them. Of course, we don't close the loop entirely, but what we then do is we analyze the acoustic properties of that music using computation, the kinds of structural properties I talk about, and then we build classifiers, essentially using contemporary machine learning artificial intelligence techniques, to predict on any incoming song how likely would that be to be on a playlist that says de-stress. So that's on the one end. On the other end, from over 10 million to N of 10, we do much more controlled studies in particular conditions. We've done analysis of the effect of music characteristics on high-intensity interval training with an elite sporting clinic that trains most of the Formula One starting pilots. And we're looking at others in the areas of sleep, relaxation. So this is where we can actually control and put more sensors. And very interesting area, though, which I'll talk more about today, is where we go out, in a way, into the wild and involve the entire community of curious people around the world to generate data. And one way we have done that recently is we've actually built a bot. This is available on Slack. It requires Spotify, so you do need to be in a country or have access to Spotify, where Spotify is present. But essentially what this does is every morning it delivers a personalized track, a set of music for you to concentrate. We all know the feeling of a good, productive morning when we happen to the work and not the other way around. And music can help with that. So every morning, it takes 30 seconds to install. Now, you might say, this is a track that was sent to me. I happen to like John Hopkins and Chiasmos. The point isn't, do you like John Hopkins or Chiasmos? It's just that it was tailored to me. Artist, either them or inspired by them, and then trained by our classifiers. So if you go to syncmusicbot.com, you can install this. It takes no time at all. And we're constantly, people are rating how are these effective. Another kind of, not quite at such scale as this, but remember Max Richter's music? Max Richter has also written a piece of music called Sleep. It's 8 hours long. And there will be a live performance of Sleep in London in May at Old Billingsgate Market, 450 beds, sold out in 2 hours. And we've partnered with Max Richter and the Barbican to actually give these sleep measurement rings to a fraction of the audience and involve them in a study looking at the effects of sleep of the piece of music itself. And we're obviously analyzing the structural properties of the music. And what I think is very interesting about this is how keen the composer is to find out and how curious he is about what is actually going on. Of course, writing it with intuitive and extreme craft and musicianship, what he thinks will be it, but now there'll be a closed loop of data. So we're looking forward to that. Now, based on all this data collected, we developed these personalized music therapeutics using contemporary machine learning techniques. And you may ask which kinds of conditions are most promising. We think that because we are in a new area, challenging large parts of the healthcare industry with these non-drug modalities, so non-drug things that have near drug-like effects, we think we need to go after large conditions, not small. And that's because we need to get breadth and something where we think we can charge appropriate amounts of money. Sleep, relaxation, anxiety is a strong area of focus for us, as is pain. I already mentioned some of the background studies. And we're focusing first on sleep, relaxation, anxiety as a cluster, and then moving on more to pain. Now, the therapeutic itself takes two kinds of forms. The first is, as you saw with the bot, sculpted playlists. So these are essentially curation based on what we understand about the functional effects of music for a particular health and wellness outcome. And we sculpt these playlists. They're dynamic and they're personalized, so they're changing every day. And this is just a layer on top of existing music services. And so in a way, we're doing something that the music services eventually will need to do. We're just doing it better now and with a functional outcome. But we're very interested in another kind of therapeutic, which we call generative music. Now, generative music, if you're not familiar with it, is music that is programmed rather than composed. So it's an artist creating a set of rules that create the music. Perhaps the canonical example is Brian Eno's Thursday Afternoon. I'm curious how many people have heard Thursday Afternoon in this audience. Many more people can and should, please. Composed in 1985, this recording is actually just, in a way, one snapshot of a process that's running constantly. So setting up a set of rules that then play out the music over time. And we're particularly interested in this is to take this one step further, to make music that is responsive to your physiology. So part of the rules that are creating the music involve input from your physiology. And an area where we think this is most appropriate in the short term is actually relaxation, more relaxation response. So that first cluster of conditions we're going after. And particularly we're looking at relaxation before sleep. So seeing whether we can use music to relax you prior to sleep, to improve sleep. Now, we have heard that Cape Town has the nickname Slapstad, or Sleepy Town. Now, we take no position on this, but what this essentially means, I've heard, is that that Cape Town is more chill, laid back, compared to, say, Joburg in South Africa. Now, so what we thought would be appropriate is that tonight Slapstad puts the whole world to sleep. And so right here tonight, we're announcing a world first. It's called Unwind, and it's an experiment, a personalized music experiment to help you relax prior to sleep using generative music. I'm going to put on a little sample in the background. Now, anyone interested in improving your relaxation and sleep quality can try this experiment with your smartphone. Any reasonably modern smartphone will do. You just point your browser to unwind.syncproject.co, and it's free to participate. And you can try it as many times as you like. Let me just walk you through the experience quickly. So before we start any of the music, we ask you to hold your phone still for a few seconds, just quietly, like this. We then magically, based on that, determine your heart rate. Then a few seconds later, the music will start playing, and it'll use your heart rate as input into the music. The aim is to match you in your current state, a principle from music therapy called the ISO principle, and then to unwind you from there. And before the music and after the music, we ask you a few questions about your perceived state of relaxation. Now, the question, of course, is what kind of music is this? And so our view is that the best result is achieved by combining machine intelligence and human creativity and intelligence. So we've partnered with a British, remarkable British musician trio called Marconi Union. Marconi Union's music defies categorization in a way, but they are known most recently, a few years ago, for a track called Weightless, one of the most streamed ambient, if you want to use that category, tracks of recent time. And what we've done is we've collaborated with Marconi Union. Weightless was dubbed, for a little while, the most relaxing track ever composed. There were some measurements done on it. And what we did was Marconi Union made a new track called Adrift, gave us all the source stems, and then we worked together with them to develop the initial rules that react and adapt to that. So what kind of music is this, really? It's essentially combining artificial intelligence and machine learning techniques with human musicianship and your physiology. And my request to you is to share this now to the world. Help Schlapstadt put the world to sleep. Try it tonight. I know there'll be parties at Design Indaba, especially then maybe we need this relaxation prior to sleep. And then tell your friends. There's a 20-minute version prior to sleep that you can do, or a 5-minute version at any time during the day. And we hope that you will like the experience as much as we've enjoyed it and making it together with Marconi Union. And we recommend that you do this for 7 days for persistent effect. Now, this whole system learns as more people use it. And so we end up with a system that will constantly evolve to you over time. Now, these are experiments, and speaking candidly, these experiments in and of themselves are products. So we expect people to get benefit from using Unwind and contributing data in the process. But there's also a question of commercializing and making music as medicine into a business. We're a privately funded venture company. And what we see is taking this data and then commercializing it as therapeutics, especially using voice-based user interfaces as the delivery mechanism. Because one of the issues with sleep as well is screen time before sleep. We all know that. It's a challenge. And voice-based user interfaces like Alexa, Google Home, and others are very, very well placed for that. So we see this initially as direct to people's subscriptions, and over time as the data grows, more and more parties in the healthcare system will be interested in complementing or replacing pharmaceuticals of this kind. Now, many pieces of music end with a coda, and I'd like to end it with a personal coda. And this has to do with what is the twisted path from being the head of the design studio at Nokia, extreme industrial craft, where 1.2 billion devices and software, hardware, packaging, to then working on building a system to deliver music as precision medicine. And here, my personal history leads, and I'm very thankful for it, to the MIT Media Lab, where I've been a director's fellow after Nokia, and particularly Joey Ito, the director. And I believe more than in any other place at the moment, the intersection of design and science is making breakthroughs at the Media Lab. If you have not looked at the new Journal of Design and Science, please take a look. Really looking at a lot of themes around this area and constantly evolving. That's a collaboration between the Media Lab and MIT Press. As well as Joe Ito's and Jeff Howe's book, Whiplash, which, by the way, if I may name check a little bit, our wonderful MC, one of our MCs, Michael, did the design of the book, which is extraordinary and worth getting in paper in addition to digitally. One of the principles that comes out in this book, which I think explains this path and my interest, is systems over objects. So changing our point of view from a focus on objects to the entire systems around them. And a particular thing follows when you take this point of view, which is that you no longer see yourself as an observer, even if you're a very user-centered observer, if you want to use that lingo, but you become a participant in the system. And this act of becoming a participant in the system changes perspective and informs that. And I'll read a quote from Whiplash by Joey. This is a little PS in one of the chapters. As participant designers, we focus on changing ourselves and how we do things in order to change the world. With this new perspective, we will be able to tackle extremely important problems that don't fit neatly into the current academic system. In essence, we are seeking to redesign our very way of thinking to impact the world by impacting ourselves. Now, 10 years from today, when we're here at Design Indaba, I believe we'll consider it somewhat funny, absurd, primitive, that we did not look at these non-drug modalities, like sound and music, like video games, like lighting, as a normal part of treating health and well-being, alongside pharmaceuticals and chemicals, small molecules, biologics. And what we need to move forward is get enough data to show that these non-drug modalities can have drug-like effects. And with that view to 10 years ahead, I invite here at Design Indaba in Cape Town, all friends of design and creativity to participate in this global experiment. Thank you very much.